Hi there, I'm Linda Lamisford, a producer of Central Texas Gardener. When I started gardening, I didn't know about soil. I didn't even know how plants grew. There were a lot of products in the nurseries, but I couldn't afford them. So what I started doing is collecting leaves from the few trees in our yard and putting them into these huge cracks in our blackland prairie soil. And an elderly neighbor who was a great gardener kind of leaned over the fence and nodded her approval. Later, I got one of those wooden pallets, you know, recycled pallets, and turned it into a compost bin and started putting the compost around the yard. And I told my dad one day, wow, look at this. The soil looks so great. And he just sort of, yes, of course. Anyway, about that time, I discovered the Austin Organic Gardeners, and I started learning from them. And this year is their 75th anniversary. So joining us today, meet Mary Kraemer, who's going to tell us a little bit about their story and how they can help you.
I learned organic from my dad, too, and with his old Rodale books. And he grew up on the farm in California with fruit nuts. Olive trees there. So organic gardening is something I like to think about as a forest. Going there, you see all the accumulation of the thick layer on the forest floor. And the trees have that great resource of all the leftover bark and rotting trees, manure, leaves, dead animals. Nature's way of being organic. With all the web of the fungi and the microbes that they have there, we all know that this is now the way that carbon is actually stored. I like to think of organic this way, not just the lack of chemicals and pesticides, but the question is really, how can we imitate that in our own garden?
When the Austin Organic Gardeners started, who started it and why did they do it? That is very significant.
In 1945, Josephine and Charles Huntley really had a negative response to the Victory Gardens doing chemicals and pesticides after World War II and the real push back then to do that. I think they grew up on farms and they saw nature's way when they were growing up. And when they saw that sort of quick results from the chemicals that they felt that that was wrong. And it was just too good to be true, really.
Later, we saw some of the results from the chemical industry and the long-term effects people did not realize at the time. But that's a whole other story, and people can come to the meetings and learn more about that. One thing I loved, Josephine did this wonderful history of Austin Organic Gardeners from 1945 to 1995. And she said, yeah, the chemical gardening hype had become so thick that our suggestions put us in the category of prohibitionist in a crowded bar.
I just want to say, you know, chemical methods are so easy to use and right on the shelf with dramatic results. How can one resist or know better? You wouldn't feed your child a donut, you know, a diet of donuts all day. You probably shouldn't do that with your plants either.
Back in the beginning, the Austin Organic Gardeners met in each other's homes.
You know, like minds think alike. And they got together and they started meeting in people's homes, and you know, it started building from there, and they added person by person. And eventually they ended up as Zilker in 1965. And when it was first, you know, built, really the heart of them was to share seeds and dirt and cuttings and plants and camaraderie and ideas. And till this day, well, till the pandemic, we continue to share too. And so now we share on Zoom, and that's worked really well.
To get back to the root of organic gardening, that starts with the soil. Why is soil health so critical?
You know, soil is critical. I get this a lot where, you know, you go, well, fertilizer, compost, chemicals, you know, what are really the difference between those? And, you know, organic fertilizers add nutrients to the soil, to deficient soil. And a good soil test will tell you what you're deficient in, but compost adds forest floor type diversity of microbes and an environment for plants that mimic nature. I love to add rock fertilizers, leaves, wood mulch, grasses, mushroom compost, turkey manure, especially when I'm making berms. And this creates really a diverse soil and protects plants from changes in the environment, pests, heat, and cold.
Why is organic gardening really resurging with new gardeners, especially now, and with the climate challenges we're facing?
We've really had a big uptick in our club since the pandemic. You know, we've gone from like 500 member group on the Facebook page to 1,500 to 2,000, over 2,000 now, within the span of a few months. It's been crazy. I think when we really develop our inner world, which the pandemic has forced us to do, we realize the most important thing is feeding ourselves well and having a relationship with our food and the environment. It's also something that people have used to keep busy and work outdoors, because that's been a real benefit, I think, for everybody.
It really is. It's a great stress reliever. It's unbelievable. Yeah, go pull one of those weeds out and you're going to feel a lot better. I hear this all the time. Oh, we can spray this pesticide because it's organic. Well, yes, maybe it is, but that doesn't mean it's not going to harm beneficials, and it can wipe out a lot of insects, especially if you just apply it to everything and it's not even going to hurt the insect you're trying to target. For example, neem oil, it can harm bees if they forage on it when it's wet. So what is your philosophy about pests in the garden?
I think because we have a lot of chemicals in our house and we clean things, we kind of think we can do that outside, but I don't use any of those things. I really love that film, Biggest Little Farm. They really talk a lot about the balance you can achieve with nature in that film. I think it's really important to be observant of what comes into your garden and know how you can get your needs met with your plants, and the creatures that come can get their needs met as well. We had Sharon Lovejoy on the other night at our club, and she says it's all about teamwork and saving diversity, even in your home gardens. We can really end the us versus them opposing forces in our garden and in our lives in the fight for our food. And this can be calmed by employing the use of birds, spiders, wasps, bats, other creatures that eat insects. And the us versus them in our world can start by ending that in our garden.
I get questions every late spring or every fall. Oh, I've got all these pests on my plants and what should I do? And it's usually for a reason that you know well. Tell us what that reason is.
Things are out of season. People want to jump in with how do I kill it? And I don't. I think things go out of season and they get a variety of pests. We have much shorter seasons now with climate change, and it's making it really challenging to grow winter vegetables. Some varieties, I can't even get broccoli to work anymore.
I think, what was it last year? It was in December. Things were already bolting. I think lettuce was bolting last December.
I really think being strategic about what we plant and when is really important in varieties. But also, we need to make our soil more resistant to temperature shifts. When we are more strategic about planting dates, making our soil more resistant to temperature change, Rodale White Paper says with the use of cover crops, compost, and crop rotation, and reduced tillage, we can actually sequester more carbon than is currently emitted, tipping the needle past 100% to reverse climate change. And it also really talks to you about that forest floor idea, about how you can really create a thick layer so that the roots are covered in the winter, the roots are covered in the summer, and then when the temperature shifts, it's less likely to, you know, be damaged by those things. And really keeping water in the soil, I've noticed, is really makes a huge difference in the ability of the land to get super cold and super hot. The film that really blew my mind on PBS recently was The Molecule That Made Us. I was shocked and horrified and realized that we really have to be more cognizant about our water and growing and the future water that's coming. Molecule That Made Us also has a water footprint test on their website that can really highlight to you to what your water use looks like. I employ gray water rain gardens, rainwater catchment. I have many rooftop bucket ponds for habitats for creatures that eat insects like dragonflies. I mulch with a variety of materials to conserve water and keep it on the land longer.
The Austin Organic Gardeners has a wonderful website, countless resources, a calendar of events, and recently a wonderful video series that you produced for your 75th anniversary. Really, really good information. How can people get involved?
I have such a great team. We have worked really hard on bringing great speakers and having a video series and providing online resources and being on Facebook and Instagram. We mostly were in person, but now we're very much online. Once a month, second Monday of the month, we do a Zoom meeting, and you can find our Zoom links on either our website or our Facebook or Instagram.
What I've loved about your Zoom meetings too is that a lot of us kind of got away from going to garden club meetings, so to speak, because of home and work schedules. We just couldn't swing it. You know, it's just a lot. Or say you live sort of out of town these days with traffic pressure, it's hard to get anywhere. And so I'm really liking the fact that we can keep learning online, though I know you're going to definitely welcome when you can be back in person, because with gardening, it's, you know, the hands-on showing another person how to do it is important. And like you said, the seed swaps and all that.
We do a lot of demonstration in person too.
Can volunteers actually come out to the demonstration garden now and work with you?
We do. We have a sort of social distance Saturday morning group that comes and maintains the Zilker garden bed that we have there. And you can get our email address from the website as well if you're interested in joining that. It's only a few people at a time, but it's a pretty active group, so everyone's welcome. Once we go back in person, hope to continue Zooming so that we can continue to have an outreach. And our team has kind of been talking about how we can integrate a camera for Zoom when we meet in person.
Well, Mary, on that note, we're going to say goodbye because it's a beautiful day. People want to get back out there and garden. And really, thank you for being part of the CTG team. Thank you for how you're helping gardeners in Central Texas in Austin.
Thank you so much.